Welcome to all of you who join me for this video lecture today. This lecture is part of the syllabus on Informatics and Cyber Law, a syllabus prescribed for the degree commerce students of Kerala University. And we will be discussing today the last part of the third unit known as Social Informatics. And in this lecture, we will be dealing with electronic waste, green computing, impact of IT in language and culture, and finally, internationalization and localization. There is a close relationship between the technological advancement and the preservation of the environment. Technological advancement is a tool of human growth. And we know we are living in a world of technology. There are devices to perform all kinds of activities. We have learned that information technology has become part and parcel of everyone's life. All the technological developments have an impact, have a consequence in the present version of the environment. We know that excessive use of electronic equipments, they are adversary to the preservation of the environment. Excessive use of electronics can lead to high energy consumption, global warming, which is a big problem today, accumulation of electronic waste, and environmental pollution. Nobody is denying the fact that technological advancements are good. Technological advancements are needed for human life. But if not used properly, they can cause harm to the environment. They can be hazardous to the environment. We shall see what is an electronic waste, or it is known as e-waste. Electronic waste or e-waste is a term for electronic products that have become unwanted, or electronic products that have become obsolete, non-working, or we can say electronic waste are these electronic products that have reached the end of their useful time. They have become old. They are no more useful. Such electronic devices are known as electronic waste. There are many types of electronic waste. So the categories of old electronic items that contribute to the e-waste are computers, televisions, monitors, cell phones, CD players, printers, fax machines, and many more. So all these electronic devices, once they have become out of use, once they have become obsolete, no more useful, they will be considered as trash. Because of the technological advances at a very high rate, many of these electronic devices are discarded after few years or after few months of use. It is because many of these devices are available in the market today for lesser price with better facilities. Therefore, many of the electronic devices that have become little old, they are easily discarded and they become the trash, the waste known as electronic waste. And we must know that electronic waste is not like other household waste. The other household waste, they get easily decomposed. They do not cause any harm to the environment. But the electronic waste, they are not mere waste. They contain some very toxic, harmful substances. Harmful substances like mercury, lead, cadmium, arsenic, etc. And these toxic materials can cause severe terminal diseases like cancer. They can very badly affect the reproductive disorders and many other health problems. Therefore, the electronic waste are a nuisance today. They are a problem today. They cause problem to the environment, and also they are hazardous to the human beings. Now, what can we do with these electronic ways? The one thing that we can do with the electronic ways are, we can try recycling the electronic ways, the obsolete devices. The e-waste can be recycled and reused in the production of goods. But very often, the reusing of electronic devices are not favored because, as I mentioned earlier, the new devices are appearing in the market day by day with better facilities and for lesser cost. So nobody wants to repair the old device and use it. There is nobody who will repair a television set today. There is nobody who wants to repair a fridge today. There is nobody who wants to repair an old desktop system. So reusing or repairing an electronic waste is not favored today. But only one thing that we can do is we can recycle. Recycling would mean that we can disassemble these electronics, separate them, categorize them, clean them, and we can use in the production of some other materials, maybe some toys or some other useful products which are used in our household. So one thing that we can do with the electronic waste is that we can recycle them, disassemble them, and use them for making some other products. But the sad fact is that only a very small percentage of the electronic waste can be recycled. It is estimated that only less than 10% of the electronic waste is recycled. The vast portion of electronic waste, they are dumped or burned or thrown in the river or in the sea. So what are the harmful effects of dumping the e-waste or burning the e-waste or throwing them in the waters? In effect, it will contaminate our soil, it will contaminate our water, it will contaminate the air. So it will lead to pollution, it will lead to harmful effects in the environment. E-waste management is a serious problem in our world today. Environmental scientists are suggesting a 3R principle by which we can manage the e-waste. The 3R stands for reduce, recycle, reuse. What is the meaning of reduce? The first R of the 3R principle is reduce. It means we must reduce the use of electronic devices. Now, we are living in a world of technology development. Everyone is using electronic devices, whether it be computer, whether it be mobile phones, or any other household devices. Most of the devices that we use are electronic devices. Now, to ask people to reduce the use of electronic devices may not be a practical one. So, among these 3R principle, the first principle, reduce, it may not be a possible principle for all of us to practice in our life. The second one is reuse. Reuse would mean that we get the old electronic devices repaired and carry on using it. I mentioned to you earlier that nobody prefers to get their electronic devices, old devices repaired, because there are better electronic devices in the market with much better facilities and for cheaper rate. Therefore, reusing an old electronic device is not a practical thing. Many want to get rid of their old devices and buy new ones. Thus, we all become part of creating electronic waste. The third and the most practical principle among the 3R principle is recycle. Recycle means we can disassemble the electronic devices, clean them, and use them in the production of some other materials. There are some companies, there are some countries which are well known for recycling the electronic devices and producing some other devices which are helpful to the humanity. So the 3R principle, that are used or that are recommended by environmental scientists to manage e-waste are reduce, reuse and recycle. Among them, the most practical ones are recycling and reusing. Now we go on to our next topic called green computing. And what is green computing? Green computing is also known as green technology. Green computing is the environmentally responsible and eco-friendly use of computers and other related resources. So, with the advancement of technology, we have just seen that all these electronic devices and e-waste can lead to harmful consequences of the environment. Harmful consequences not only for environment but for all living organisms that are on the face of the earth. So what is green computing? Green computing is being responsible. We have a responsibility towards the society. We have a responsibility towards the environment. We have a responsibility towards other living organisms. So green computing is an attempt to use computers and other related devices in an environmentally responsible manner. It is also defined as the study of designing, manufacturing, using and disposing of computing devices in a way that we reduce their harmful effect on the environment. The computer devices, the electronic devices have to be designed in such a way that they will not harm the environment. The manufacturing process, the engineering process should be in such a way that they are not harmful to the environment. The using and disposing of electronic devices should be in a way that it should not harm the environment and other living organisms. So this is the definition of green computing. Using computers and other resources in an environmentally and eco-friendly manner. We can talk about three things under this heading green computing. It will include one, implementation of energy efficient CPUs, servers, peripheral, etc. So we have to develop central processing units or other peripheral devices like maybe the monitor, the keyboard or all the other physical devices of the computer in such a way that they use energy in an efficient manner. There is no wastage of energy. Energy is conserved. So we have to design peripheral devices that will use minimum amount of energy. The second one is that reduced resource consumption. In the production and use of electronic devices, we need to carefully use the scarce resources that we have. The resources have to be carefully consumed. And the last one is proper disposal of electronic waste. We have talked about electronic waste. The electronic waste has to be properly disposed so that they do not cause harm to the environment and other living organisms. So under green computing, we can talk about three things. One is implementation of energy efficient peripheral devices. Second one is reduced resource consumption. And the third thing is proper disposal of e-waste. What are the goals of green computing? The goals of green computing are, one, to reduce the use of hazardous materials, two, to maximize energy efficiency, and three, to promote the recyclability of the products. We have learned when we discussed about e-waste that the electronic waste contain hazardous materials that can cause harm to the environment, that can cause harm to the living organisms. Therefore, one of the aims of green computing is to reduce the use of hazardous materials. One way to reduce the use of hazardous materials is to move on to biocomputing. When we have discussed about biocomputing, we have said that computers are developed mimicking the living organisms. Biological molecules like DNAs and proteins are used for the development of computers. So one of the ways to reduce hazardous materials is to use biocomputing. The second objective, the second goal of green computing is to maximize energy efficiency during the product's lifetime. It would mean to minimize improper use of power consumption. And the third goal of green computing is to promote recyclability, which we have discussed earlier when we talked about e-waste. Many countries have come up with a lot of green computing initiatives. And the pioneer, the first country that came with green computing initiative is the United States, with a voluntary program known as Energy Star. It was conceived by the Environment Protection Agency, EPA, in 1992 to promote energy efficiency in electronic items like laptops, microwave ovens, air conditioners, etc. The Energy Star label became very common and has been adopted by many European and Asian countries. Thus, the Green Computing Initiative was pioneered by the USA through a program called Energy Star. Now that has been taken up by, adopted by countries in Europe and in Asia. There are four complementary approaches to green computing. What are the four complementary approaches? One, green use. Two, green disposal. Three, green design. And four, green manufacturing. What is green use? Green use would mean minimizing the electricity or power consumption of computers and their peripheral devices and using them in an eco-friendly manner. So, minimize the power consumption and use the computers use the electronic devices in an eco-friendly manner. That is green use. Now, what is green disposal? Green disposal is talking about e-waste, disposing of e-waste, recycling or reusing of electronic waste, repurposing an existing computer or appropriately disposing or recycling of unwanted electronic equipment. So, green disposal is talking about e-waste management. As far as possible, recycle them, reuse them, and when we dispose them, you must dispose them in a manner such that it does not harm the environment. The third complementary approach to green computing is green design. Designing energy efficient computers, servers, printers, projectors and all the other electronic devices. The last complementary approach to green computing is green manufacturing. What is green manufacturing? It is minimizing waste during the manufacturing of computers and other electronic devices. So we can say there are four complementary approaches to green computing. They are green use, green disposal, green design, and green manufacturing. Everybody who uses electronic devices can be part of this green computing. So as a user, or as a student, or as a teacher, I can participate in this green computing. What are some of the ways in which we can also participate in green computing? Some of them are listed here. The first way to participate in green computing is to use the hibernate or sleep mode when you are away from the computer for some time. So it will help to conserve energy. The second one is to use flat screen or LCD monitors instead of using CRT monitors. We know CRT monitors like television, they occupy big space over the desktop. It contains a lot of electronic components inside that. So the flat panels are smaller in size. It can be easily kept on the desktop. So it is more convenient and smaller. So use these flat panel screens, monitors like LED screens or LCD screens instead of the CRT monitors. The third one is buy energy efficient notebook computers instead of desktop computers. Today there are so many portable and mobile computing devices and they can be used instead of the desktop. Now these portable computer devices, they can be charged and recharged. They don't need to be full time fixed onto the power connection. So it can be helpful in using the energy efficiently. The next point is to activate the power management features for controlling energy consumption. It is also talking about minimizing the energy consumption. The next one is to make proper arrangements for sale of electronic waste. As far as possible, reuse, get your electronic devices, get repaired instead of going for brand new ones every time. Suppose you are disposing them, you must do it properly. Next one is to turn off computers at the end of each day. We can be so careless that we can leave the workplace or we can leave the laptops and the desktops on for the whole night even. We will plug on to the power and leave it as it is and leave the workplace. So make sure that whenever you stop your work, you must shut down your computer. Next one is to refill printer cartridges rather than buying new ones. It is possible to refill the cartridge. Once the cartridge is over, instead of disposing them and buying a new one, we can always refill the cartridge. And the last point is, instead of buying a new electronic device or a new computer, once your computer becomes a little old, reuse them, get a repair, refurnish them and use them again so that you do not contribute much to the e-waste. So these are some of the ways in which, as an ordinary user, as a student or as a teacher, we can participate in the project of green computing. We go on to the next topic called impact of IT on language and culture. We know what is a culture. Culture is a set of norms, rules, etc. that are held by a group of people as a whole. Culture consists of the language we speak, the food habits, the dress code, and the etiquette that is followed in a community, the ways of greeting each other, etc. So culture consists of a lot of aspects. One important aspect of culture is language. And we are going to see that information technology has influenced the language of communication. It has changed the way we communicate and process information. Now, information technology is also known as information systems. These are used to gather, these are used to process, store, and transfer information. Today, all the information processing is done using computers. Nobody resorts to the old methods of storing information. Everybody is using electronic media to process information. Similarly, the communication methods have changed. The communication facilities available on the internet are varied, like email or chats or voice over internet protocol, social networking sites, video conferencing. There are so many communication facilities that are available on the internet. So we can say that IT has got a very big impact on the language and communication that is prevalent in every culture. Another impact that IT has brought forth is that it has reduced the distance between people. Today we can communicate with people who are not near us, who are in a faraway land, other countries, using internet. There are no more borders. People are not kept apart. Even people who are living in different countries and different parts of the world can very easily and instantly communicate with each other. This would say that the impact of IT in culture is very big, and yet it has reduced the distance between people. It has blurred the borders that kept the people apart. Information technology has had a lot of impact on the language. It is said the impact of information technology on language is astonishing. The way we communicate has changed the English language forever. The communications that we make using the information technology, using internet, has changed the English language. The English language is enriched with a lot of new vocabulary. For example, email. Email has changed the structure of the letter as a communication tool. We are used to sending letters or birthday cards, letters to people, or business letters from organizations. With the advent of email, the structure of letters have gone through a drastic change. It brought with it a whole new etiquette and new conventions, new abbreviations. For example, some abbreviations are given there. IMO, it stands for in my opinion. FWIW, it stands for what it's worth. IIRC, it stands for, if I remember correctly. FYI, it stands for your information. So we can say that the IT, information technology, has brought in lot of difference in the structure of communication. It has enriched the English language. It has brought in lot of abbreviations which are frequently used in internet communications or computer communications. One important aspect of information technology and communication technology are the portable handheld communication device called mobile phone, the cellular phone. The mobile phone users have created a new language culture. Sending text messages is now almost as common as talking on mobile phones. The way we write our text messages is now so widely accepted that it has infiltrated mainstream advertising. The mobile messages, shorthand words, the codes, the abbreviations that we use in sending messages over mobile, they have been adopted by many advertising companies. Thus, we can say that information technology, internet, and mobiles are influencing positively the languages. It is in enhancing the language, it is adding to the vocabulary, it is adding new abbreviations. Thus, we can say that information technology has a big positive impact on languages. Like email, like mobile phones, there are also social networking sites and blogs. These also positively influence the languages. Now, there are over 100 million blogs worldwide. Blogs would mean personal websites where people can write their opinions. They can comment on anything that happens in society. They can write criticisms, etc. And there are so many people who read these blogs. So, reading and writing blogs also improves languages. So, blogs are a means to better the language. Similarly, there is tremendous growth in social networking sites. Everybody is using these social networking sites for communication. There is Facebook, there is Hi-Fi or the WhatsApp. There are millions of people who are active in social networking sites. And we can say that the communication over these social networking sites are positively enhancing the languages. It is bringing in new vocabularies. It is bringing in new abbreviations. So we can say information technology, which consists of internet, computers, mobile phones, social networking sites, and all the communication facilities over the internet, are enhancing the language and the culture of the people. In continuing our discussion with the impact of IT on language and culture, we can say that innovations in IT are the most important source for social change. Social change would mean that the society is moving from one stage to another. There are a lot of improvements in the quality of the life of the people because of information technology. The technology is a cause for improving the quality of the life of the people. One advancement that is happening is the technology revolution increases the possibility for people to work from home. That is an enhancement of the culture. This is perhaps the greatest foreseeable social impact it will have on the developed world. So you don't need to race to your office every day in the morning. There is a possibility of working from home. You are able to work from home and fulfill all the requirements, all the duties of your office sitting in your home because of the availability of internet and the availability of electronic devices. So this information technology, with the advent of internet and all modes of communication, means of communication, these technological advances have made this social change, this change for the better, we are able to work from home. So that is considered as one of the greatest impact of IT on culture. As work from home has enhanced the culture, similarly, all the communication facilities available on the internet, especially email, it allows us to quickly communicate with co-workers and customers who may be located on another part of the world. The internet puts a world of information immediately at our fingertips. Communication is instant communication. Information is instant information. With a click of a mouse or with the touch of a finger, the required information is available to us. We are communicating, we can communicate with anybody in any part of the world. But there is a danger also. When we are engaging ourselves too much online, it is probable that we lack proper communication with people who are around us. We constantly live online and very often we lose touch with the reality around us. We lose touch with people who are living around us. This is a big danger that can happen when we are constantly involved with all kinds of communication and information online. Thus, we can say that information technology has got a huge impact on language and culture. Information technology decides how we communicate with people, how we relate with people. Information technology decides how cities grow, where people live, who owns what. Information technology will decide how we socialize, how we make friends. Information technology is the reason for a few people to be rich. Information technology will decide how we teach, how we learn, how students interact with one another. So we can say that information technology is having a huge impact on every person's in every walk of life, our communication, our job, our facilities, the way we make friends. Everything is decided by information technology. So we can say that information technology has got a huge impact on our culture and our language. The last topic that we will discuss today is internationalization and localization. So in computing, what is the meaning of internationalization and localization? They mean adapting computer software to a different language or adapting computer software to regional differences and technical requirements of a regional target market. So internationalization, you must produce computer devices for the international market. At the same time, localization or adapting software to a local language to the regional difference is a requirement. So what is the meaning of internationalization? It would mean designing a software application so that it can be easily adapted to various languages and various regions without making any changes in the design, without making engineering changes. So internationalization would mean that the software application that you have created, you have designed, can be easily adapted to different regions, different languages without changes in the engineering. So what is the meaning of localization? Localization is a process of adapting internationalized software for a specific region or a specific language by adding local specific components and translating text. For example, a software must support the character set of a local language, maybe of a Malayalam language or of a Hindi language, so that, and it must be configured to present numbers and other values of the local format, dates or numbers of the local format. So localizing a word processor would mean that you need to have a spell checker of the local language. So internationalization and localization, Internationalization would mean that you have to design a software application so that it can be easily adapted to a particular region without making changes in the engineering. The process of adapting to a particular region or language is known as localization. So, what is the advantage of localization? It will enable non-English speaking users around the world to benefit from the technology. Language translation is only a small part of localization, but localization involves modifying the product to consider the cultural and political sensitivities like date, time, currency format, and social factors, so that the local users can easily interact with the technology. So, localization is an important aspect, especially if you want your products to be sold in the market, in the local market, localization is necessary. So, localization does not mean the translation of the language, but it means modifying the product according to the cultural requirements of the region. We can say that localization is a requirement. It is a requirement for software companies. If the software companies want to sell their software internationally, they must invest considerable amount of money and energy in localization efforts. Otherwise, these software products will not be sold in local markets. There are also companies who specialize in localizing software product for third parties. So, my dear students, we have discussed four topics today. The first one was electronic waste. Then we talked about green computing. Then we talked about impact of information technology on language and culture. And finally, we have discussed internationalization and localization. As I mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, this was the last part of the third unit known as social informatics of informatics and cyber law of the Kerala University students, commerce students. I hope the video was useful to you, and I thank all of you for your patient listening.